Glad to see you as well. There we are, loud and clear. Okay, I've got a couple of announcements to lift up to you, then we're going to begin our time of worship. So, what's April the 1st?
April Fool's!
Women's Conference, okay, unexpected. April the 1st, we got about 187 women, okay? We've got, yeah, give it up, that's awesome. But we got 200 spots, so we got place for a few more people. And one of those people might be you, okay? So sign up now if you're wondering. There's a sheet right over here that tells about it. Unexpected. We'd love to have you. Also want to share with you, men, you have an opportunity at 12 o'clock on Wednesday. We're going to set up everything. And I know we've got a team of men that's already signed up. But if you're willing to come out and help, Wednesday at 12 o'clock, we're going to set this up for the women's event. And then Friday at 6 o'clock, anybody that would be interested in assisting men-wise, come out about 6 o'clock, and we're going to be trained, okay? We're going to be told what to do.
What?
Does that sound familiar? Jenny's going to tell us what to do, okay? And we're glad of that, okay? We are going to serve, men. We are going to be called to serve. That is April the 1st. Now, we also have an Easter egg hunt. And if you'll notice, there's a basket back there that says candy. So bring me all your candy, okay? And we'll put it in Easter eggs for the kids, and they'll have a great time. But guess what? You can come as well, because we're going to have some hot dogs, okay? We're going to celebrate. Beth has got some crafts and ideas for the kids, and we're just going to have a great time. It's a community-wide event, so reach out to the community, invite people for that Easter egg hunt. And then mark your calendars, a sunrise service for Easter. We're going to kick off that day at 7:30 right out here at the cross. We'll have a sunrise service, and then we're going to have some little knickknacks and things to munch on. And then we'll have our regular services at 8:45 and 11 o'clock, okay? We are going to celebrate Easter in a big, big, big way. So come on out and invite someone to join us. I'd like to see every chair in this place full.
Amen.
And every pew in the sanctuary full.
Yep.
Okay? Why? Because it's Easter and it's worth celebrating. So come out and be a part of that. Those are the announcements I have. We got one about Emmaus.
Yeah. Yes. Emmaus Walk is coming up. Please be in prayer. If you have anybody that you want to sponsor, get those applications in like this week. Like, do it tomorrow. And send it in. Both walks could use pilgrims. If you walked with a full walk of like 24 pilgrims, you know how amazing that is. So let's send people. I don't think we have anybody going yet from Salem, so it may be you.
Okay. All right. If you want to know more about Emmaus, you can see Kelly right after the service, and she'll fill you in, okay? Let's open with prayer and begin time of worship, okay? Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this day that you've given to us. Lord, when we look at the news and we see the snowstorms in California, the flooding that's taking place there, and it prevents some people from getting out of their homes and their houses, and I can't imagine the devastation, Lord. And when I think about across Mississippi and Arkansas and those areas that suffered tornadoes and storms, and Lord, here we are in North Carolina, and we have an opportunity to be here in your house and to worship and thank you. Lord, every chair ought to be full and we ought to be giving thanks, Lord.
Yes.
We are blessed. And Lord, I pray that you just fill us with your spirit, Lord. Yes. That all that we say, all that we do, the words that we sing, Lord, will bring praise, honor, and glory to you. It's all about you, Lord.
Yes.
It's not about us.
Yes.
And we lift your name on high in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's sing.
Amen, amen. Let's all stand up and worship him this morning.
Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing glory to his name. Give him all of the glory. His works in everyone. How wonderful is he. God has done for me. He listened and heard my prayer. Praise to God who hasn't turned to flee. He knows my every care. Let his praises fill the air. Come and see what the Lord has done. How awesome are his works in everyone. How wonderful his deeds. How great is his power. He will take your breath. Sound of his praises be heard. He has tested us with fire, refined us like silver. He will take your breath away. Oh, give glory to his name. Come and see what the Lord has done. How awesome are his works in everyone. How wonderful his deeds, how great is his power. He will take your breath away. Oh, give glory to his name. Oh, give glory to his name. Give all glory to his name. Give glory.
Give him glory today. Amen. So I have a quick farm story for you. I was out all day yesterday, came back home, and my daughter came running in. She said one of our horses had a cut on his side. And I was like, oh, okay, well, we'll just, you know, spray it with something. She goes, it's bad, Mom. And I was like, oh, no. I went out, and I think he laid on a limb, went to roll on a limb or something. He impaled himself. And I was like, oh, no, this isn't good. So I call the vet. The vet's not responding. I call other vets. I get through, but it's going to be $300 just to walk in my door, you know, before. I was like, oh, no. So I'm like, okay, we're going to wait for the vet. So I sat on my porch, and I just felt like God going, be still. Just be still in my presence. Now, I'm going to tell you that I don't want you to think that I'm super spiritual, because on Friday, I lost my Jesus. Okay? I've been praying for the UPS customer service representative that I talked to, because I didn't cuss, y'all, but I wasn't there. I wasn't nice. And I literally had a panic attack on Friday with something else that happened. It's been a week of just pressure, 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 just random things happening. And finally, yesterday, I was like, all right, Lord. Well, Emmaus is coming up. We've got our last meeting this Saturday. And it usually starts, that pressure usually starts maybe 2 weeks before, and the enemy's got a little head start this year. I don't know what's going on. But you know, if you've gone, you know that that is a life-changing event. And this morning, I went into Facebook, just peeked at it real quick. The first post was Angela asking for prayer over something. And I'm like, okay, it's got to be Emmaus. And Julie France is also on our team. And I would be willing to bet that she's got some stories. So Julie, if you're here, know that it's not just random. The enemy's like out to get us. So what I want to employ our church. Will you pray for us? Pray for the walk to Emmaus. Pray for the team. Pray for the pilgrims that are supposed to be there. Pray that they're able to go, because I've got a pilgrim that I was trying to send, and she can't go, randomly can't go. And I'm like, the enemy's just. So please pray. Because God is good. And in the end, he wins, right? And if I didn't have all of this, if we didn't have trials, actually, we should be expecting trials, right? That's what the Bible says. We should be expecting trouble. And that's what strengthens us. So I got a do-over from Friday to do it better. And I think I did it a little bit better yesterday, instead of having a panic attack, which, and fear, which fear is not from, not from God. God has not given us a spirit of fear. So somebody needed to hear that today. You're in a panic. God hasn't given you a spirit of fear. So rest in him. Be still in him. Let's continue to worship him this morning. Oh, the horse is okay. I'm sorry. I didn't finish the story. The horse. So the vet did come out. He was there at 9 o'clock last night. He stitched him up. He said there wasn't any, they were afraid that it went into his his abdominal cavity, and he said it did not. So he stitched him up, and I've got a lot of pain meds to give him, and I've got to flush it out once a day. 2 weeks, the stitches come out. So we're all good in that front. So thank you for asking. Let's continue worshiping.
You never stop working.
never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
That is who you are. You are our way maker. You're our strength and our song. I'm so thankful that I got a chance to have a do-over, that you give us some do-overs. Thank you for your grace, Lord. Thank you that you hear our prayers, and even though I don't know the name of the lady that I was unkind to, Lord, you know her. I pray that you would pour out your blessings on her. And Lord, I pray that you would guard my mouth and my heart. God, kindness is one of the fruit of the Spirit. We're supposed to be kind and good and loving and faithful and self-disciplined. Thank you that even when we don't see it, you're working. I'm thankful that my horse wasn't injured any worse than he was. The vet was like, I'm scared of that. I sent him a picture. He said, I'm scared of that one. We might have had to put him down. But God. And you care about everything. You care about everything. There's nothing too small that you don't care about. So, Lord, impress on us those small prayers that we need to lift up to you. To watch you move in powerful ways and help us to be still before you. And God, as we continue to worship with our tithes and our offerings, I pray that you would take it, multiply it, and bless it, and use it to further your kingdom, Lord. We have all these empty seats, Lord. And I know my son is so excited. He invited people to come to church. We all know somebody who lives around here, Lord. Impress on us someone to invite. They will come on Easter. Lord, fill this place with your presence. And fill this place with your people. We love you and we praise you. I pray for a continued blessing and presence through the rest of this service, Lord. We love you. It's in your name we pray. It's your breath in our lungs. Lord, you are great and greatly to be praised. And Lord, we're so thankful for the promises in your word that you inhabit the praises of your people. You're here. You filled this place because we filled our lungs with breath and given you praise. Oh, Lord, thank you. I pray that you would continue to bless us with your presence as your word is spoken and we open up and study your word. I pray for a special anointing on our pastor, and I pray that you would use him for your glory. Make us sponges, Lord. Soak us up. Fill us up, Lord. This is our battery recharge. Lord, we love you and we praise you. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
They experienced the temporary forgiveness of sins by the blood of an animal sacrifice. In the book of Leviticus, the Lord speaks to Moses and he lays out the sacrifice to occur for the sins of the people. In the New Testament, the Lamb of God, God's only Son, Jesus, becomes the sacrificial lamb. The sacrifice of Jesus to leave heaven and offer himself on the cross was an atoning sacrifice that is effective throughout eternity. Through Christ, we are completely redeemed from the ashes of our former life, and we are restored to God's favor. And it's all through Christ that we can experience this new birth. Good morning, church, and I want to welcome those that are joining us online. And we've come to our fifth message in this series called From the Ashes. And I want to begin with a prayer, so let us pray. Jesus, thank you for your sacrificial life. Without your life, your death, and your resurrection, we would all be lost in our sins. Remind us today that we're no longer slaves to sin, but we are alive in you. Help us to live our lives sacrificially and be willing to lay our lives down for others. And we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. As I said today, we're going to talk about the sacrifice of Jesus and the impact of his humble actions have had on all of humankind. Now, to illustrate the idea of sacrifice, I'm going to share a story with you. Now, has anybody ever heard of, now I mispronounce this last name, so forgive me, I'm going to spell it. It's Richard Rescorla. It's R-E-S-C-O-R-L-A. Richard Rescorla. Richard was served in the British military, and then he came to the United States where he served in the U.S. military for a period of time. After his time in the military, he became the security director for Morgan Stanley in the World Trade Center in New York City. Now, Richard, they said, was a stickler for safety and was committed to making sure that the employees at Morgan Stanley and in the World Trade Center were safe. On September the 11th, 2001, just as soon as the first plane hit the North Tower, Richard immediately jumped into action, and he very calmly instructed more than 2,500 employees that he was responsible for to evacuate through the South Tower. Richard was then killed by the impact of the plane that hit the South Tower as he just managed to get everyone out. Now, the sacrifice of Richard enabled thousands to escape death and to live. And while Richard sacrificed his life for thousands, God so loved the world, imagine that, the world, that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The sacrifice of Christ, it gives life. Not just life, but eternal life. And it provides the opportunity and the victory to all who believe. Now, the sacrifice of Christ is so completely sufficient that there's no need for any other work. There's nothing else for us to do to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. But there's a lesson that we can learn from Christ in this area. So we want to get started this morning. The Apostle Paul is writing concerning Jesus, and he says these words. He says, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. Now, hold on to that thought as we continue. Okay? But he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and he became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Now think about that. Our first week we talked about not using our position and our power as Christians or even as who we are to lord over another person. Jesus gives us the example. In the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. Then also we talked about humbling ourselves. And the scripture says that he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death. Now I'm not going to belabor those points. But what I want to make take a moment for you to recognize is where there is sacrifice, there's humility. There's humility. You see, Christ willingly gave up heaven, gave up the throne to come to earth as a sacrifice for our sin. Jesus did not hold on to his position, his power, but instead he laid it all down to be a humble servant, to give up his life on a cross. Now, Jesus says this concerning his life. Here's what he has to say. He says, no one takes it from me. Okay? No one. The Roman soldiers? Pontius Pilate? The chief priests? The scribes? The people who cried out, crucify him? No one can take it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. Willingly. I have the power to lay it down and I have the power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. Jesus knew that in order to rescue the world from the curse of sin, he knew what that cost would be. He knew how he would have to suffer. In the garden, he even prays, if it be thy will, take this cup from me, but not my will, thy will be done. Willingly, he knew the cost, and Jesus willingly sacrificed his life for you and for me. Now, if you're going to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, as Paul suggests in his reading, which is what we're supposed to do as disciples of Christ, then you're going to have to experience sacrifice. You've got to be willing to sacrifice. Yeah. Thankfully, Jesus is very straightforward about sacrifice and what we must commit to become a disciple of Christ. In the Gospel of Luke, he tells it, he just lays it out for you. Here's what he says. He says that there were large crowds who were traveling with him. They were following him for all the good that he had done, the healing that he had done, and all the demons that he cast out. They followed him. And he turned to them and he said, whoever comes to me and does not hate father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Now, you know what happened, don't you? A bunch of them left. This man's crazy. He don't know what he's talking about. I'm not going to follow this crazy man. And Jesus continued, and he says, whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. They knew what that cross meant. They knew that the cross meant that they were going to have to sacrifice their life. And then a few more left. And then he goes on, he says, for which of you intending to build a tower does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid the foundations, not able to finish it, all who see it will begin to say to him and ridicule him and say, this fellow began to build, was not able to finish. Or what king going out to wage war against another king will not sit down first and consider whether he is able to, with 10,000, to oppose one who comes against him with 20,000? Yeah. If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all possessions. That's a great sacrifice. A great sacrifice. Admittedly, this is probably perhaps one of the most difficult passages that there is found in the New Testament. But Jesus wants us to understand and know the sacrifice that it takes for us. Jesus challenges, listen, are you willing to sacrifice family, plans, position? Are you willing to go up against all odds when everybody says are against you, when the world seems to turn against you? Are you willing to follow me and to stand up for me? To paraphrase that, it's saying, are you willing to let go of everything, give it all up to follow Jesus? In fact, Jesus later says in Matthew, he says, if anybody wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Now, we try to skirt around all this, don't we? Yeah, but, you know. No, he's willing. If Christ sacrificed himself to bring redemption, then we must be willing to do the same, to share that redemption. You see, people come to me and they said, you know, what does God look like? I can't see God. I don't understand that concept of God, or I don't know Jesus. What does Jesus look like? You say that he's alive. Well, where is he? Look around you. He's in the face of the person sitting beside of you, behind you. Yes, he's all around us. And we must be willing to sacrifice, lay it all down, and share that redemption with others so that others may come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. What does that look like for us? Well, Paul explains it like this. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. Okay? And it's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. Okay? And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. the one who sacrificed me, I'm willing to sacrifice my life for his life, for what he's done for me. You might have heard this before in Galatians, but it clearly describes our position with Christ and our engagement with the world around us. Yes, I understand discipleship and sacrifice can be difficult. It's one that you have to be willing to make. It's not a popular decision, okay? It's not a popular decision. When I made the decision to go into the ministry and accept that, it wasn't an easy decision because I knew things would change. Friends and people that I'd associated and hung with no longer wanted to hang with a preacher. They no longer wanted to be around someone. I can walk in a room and the room changes. Okay? Yeah. I understand the sacrifice. I realize that. And it's one that you have to be willing to make. You have to be the one that says, yes, Lord, I'm willing to give it all up. I'm willing to surrender it all to you. You can't do it halfway. You can't ride the fence post. Yeah. You've got to be willing to let go of everything once you believe, once you held on to, once you saw those things you saw found value in. And yes, there will be opposition. And there's going to be those that's going to tell you, you're crazy. You're crazy. You don't think people come up and say, Eric, you're crazy. What do you mean? You got a good job, a good house? You got a family? What do you mean? Yeah. Jesus tells it that way. He says, here's what he says. He said, you will be hated by all because of my name. Okay? But he says, listen to me. He says, listen, you're going to suffer and be persecuted, just like you'd mentioned, you know? You're going to suffer and you're going to be persecuted. There's going to a lot happen. April the 1st, we got this women's thing. And let me tell you something. There's going to be a lot happen between now and then. Okay? A lot happen because you know what? Old Satan don't want 200 women in this place praising God. They might just turn Denver upside down. Okay? You hear me? You better be praying for it. You better be praying for those that are speaking. You better be praying for the women. Okay? Better be praying for the men that's serving. Okay? You're going to be persecuted. But here's what Jesus says. Jesus promises this. He says, I'm not going to leave you orphaned. I'm not going to leave you out there by yourself. You're not alone. Yeah. He says this. He says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask the Father, and he's going to give you an advocate to be with you. An advocate. Someone who's going to walk with you every step of the way through the journey that you have to take. Someone that's going to be there to lift you up. That's what an advocate is. Advocate is somebody that says, well, wait a minute here. You talk to me. You're going to deal with me. That's an advocate. Going to be there for you. And that's what Jesus says. You're not going to be orphaned. I'm going to send an advocate. If you love me and keep my commandments, I'm going to send the advocate who will be there with you. Okay? So as you let go of those things, as you realize and begin to sacrifice, you're not alone in your sacrifice. Know that. You're not alone in your sacrifice. Listen to what it says here in the scriptures. It says, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, okay? But we have one who in every respect has been tested as we have, and yet without sin. Talking about Jesus there. I told you. He is baptized. What happened to him? He got out in the wilderness. He was tempted. He endured. He went through everything that you ever imagined, ever dealt with, or ever will deal with. Experienced it. There's nothing that you can ever experience that Jesus has not experienced. He did. So let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness. Not braggingly, with boldness. What does that mean? I can come before the throne of God because He understands what I mean. He understands my struggles. He understands my situation. Why? So that we may receive mercy and find the grace in the time of need. Yeah. Sacrifice, folks, takes courage. It takes courage. It takes conviction. It takes a little bit of confidence. Now reflect that on for a minute. Reflect about the times in your life that you sacrificed for something. Okay? Maybe it was a car. Maybe you saved up for a car. Okay, I told you here a while back about my car that I bought when I was 16 years old. Man, I'm telling you, I held on to every nickel and dime. I didn't go no ice cream, no hamburgers. I saved that money because I sacrificed because I wanted to buy that car. Think about that sacrifice you made, maybe to buy a car, or maybe you said, I wanted to put a down payment on a house, so you sacrificed. I sold a motorcycle one time because I needed a down payment for a house. How about a job? Maybe you had to move to a new area, a new place, a new location. New responsibilities. Sacrifice for a job, or how about education? Do something. I had to sacrifice so that I can. Now think about that. Study on that. How did you feel once you got that car or bought that house or got into that new job or maybe got that degree that you had to sacrifice for? Man, didn't you say, man, this was worth all the sacrifice. This was worth all that I went through, this was worth it. And those are earthly treasures. Think about that. Earthly treasures. Yeah. But what was it? What was it while you were sacrificed? While you was in the midst of sacrificing? What was it that you stayed focused, didn't you? You were encouraged that, oh man, okay, look. I made it 1 week. I made it 2 weeks. I made it 3 weeks or whatever. Or you'll put back a dollar or $2 or $3. The encouragement is what kept you focused. So here's some words of encouragement. I read this last week to you. It says, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. Sacrifice. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Encouragement. For the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. Now hold that right there a minute. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy of going to the cross, of enduring the cross, how is there joy in that? How is there joy in that? Think about that. The joy is that the scripture says there's more rejoicing in heaven for one sinner that comes to know him than 99 righteous people. He was willing to suffer, and the joy was to know that yours and my sins are forgiven. He offered it freely to all of us. Jesus sacrificed his life for the joy set before him. Now let me tell you today, this is very real, deep, abiding joy in serving others and sacrificing your life for someone else. Now think about this. Think about this for a moment. Think about the last time that you sacrificed your energy, your time, your money for something. Some project, service project. Or maybe you went somewhere. In February, I guess it was, we went to Belize, January. Okay, we went to Belize, and those that went with me, they some of them took vacation time. They sacrificed their vacation time to go. They gave their own money to go, okay, on this trip to Belize. Think about that, okay? Now think about when the project was done, how you felt. I tell you right now, that first night we got through in Belize, we were absolutely wore out. We worked too hard and it was too hot, and we had a couple people that even got sick, you know, that dehydrated. And we were going back and we were tired. But there was a joy. There was a feeling of joy that was there. And answer that. You know that. Yeah. Those things that you sacrificed for, that you gave to, and then all of a sudden when it was over, you felt, man, this felt great. Deep inside, no matter what. Last week, one of the confirmands, they asked questions. Jenny said, you can ask any question you want to the preacher, and he'll answer it. Put me on the spot. But anyway, one of them asked the question concerning my call into the ministry. And they said, how old were you when you went into the ministry? And I said, well, I was 45 years old. Okay? Stop doing the math. Anyway, they said, well, why? You know, and I began thinking about that, and I began to think about the sacrifices that had to be made along the way. You know, and there were a lot of sacrifices along the way. First off, my family had to sacrifice. They had to move out of the home that we lived in into another home in a different location. They had to go to different schools. Yeah, had to meet new friends, new people. Yeah, my wife had to get a job. That time she was a stay-at-home mom. She worked part-time at a Mother's Morning Out. But anyway, she had to get a job. There were times when my family was spending Thanksgiving with their family, and I was preaching a funeral or preaching a worship service. Many a time on Christmas, while you and my family was doing Christmas presents, I was doing Christmas Eve services, Christmas Sunday services. My family sacrificed a great deal. I sacrificed a great deal. But you know what? As I began thinking about that, that wasn't what I focused on. The focus that focused me was the joy. The joy when I began to see how God took a life that was in the midst of the ashes and how God brought that life back to life. The joy that I found was walking with a family who was going through a difficult situation, struggling, and that God could use me as his vessel. The joy was being there when holding that newborn baby and seeing life. The joy was being there with that family as they were saying goodbye to their loved one, knowing that God had them in the palm of his hand. The joy was seeing that baptism of an infant or a child or even adult, and watching them grow in spirit and grace for the kingdom of God. Oh, what joy. It far outweighed those sacrifices, those things that I had to give up and sacrifice for. It reminds me of that great old hymn. I'm going to try it. Shackled by a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And now, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know. He touched me and made me whole. You know, when we begin to trade those selfish desires, those wants for our life, to become a disciple of Christ and to serve others, those sacrifices that we make, they have meaning and they have purpose. They have names and faces that are attached to them. And when we serve others, we can see our selfless acts through Christ. Without the sacrifice of Christ, there's no redemption. No, we'd be lost in our sins. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's what the scripture says. So without the sacrifice and all those saints who have gone before us, there's no church. Sacrifice is powerful. It can change someone's life who needs help. And it can redeem someone's eternity. Remember what I said? You know, more people come to experience Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior by the relationship of His people than they ever do from a sermon that a preacher preaches. Okay? Yeah. Think about that for a moment. No matter how hard life has been, no matter how far from God that you may feel that you are right now, this day. Listen, I want you to know something. No matter how irredeemable you believe your life to be, the sacrifice that Christ made on that cross is completely sufficient to take care of you and to offer you that forgiveness that you need for your life. Paul writes these words. He says, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." Yeah, you and me. "Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." He climbed up there and laid out there and let them nail Him to that cross with no guarantees that anybody would take Him up on the offer. One of them said, "If you are the Son of God, if you are who they say you are, why don't you come off that cross and take us with you?" And the other one says, We are receiving that which we are guilty of. Death. The wages of sin are death. And then he turned to him and said, "Remember me." And Jesus said, This day you will be with me in paradise. Yes. Today, listen, today is as good as any day to rise above that sin, that shame that you're feeling, and to accept the free gift that God has given to every one of us through His Son, Jesus Christ. "Since I've met this blessed Savior, since He cleansed and made me whole, oh, I'll never cease to praise Him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know. He touched me, and he made me whole. Chris Tomlin is a writer, a gospel writer and singer. And he made this song famous, and I'm not going to sing it. But it says, amazing love, how can it be that you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that my king would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. In all I do, I honor you. You know, there are things that are worth sacrificing for. And we sacrifice. I said, you know, maybe you sacrifice to buy a new car. Maybe you sacrifice to put a down payment on a house or buy a house, a boat, or whatever. We sacrifice for those things that are of this world, that we know that, you know what, that new car I just bought, it's not new anymore. And sooner or later, it's going to break down and need an alternator. It won't work. And I sacrifice for it. But what am I willing to sacrifice for? The one who says, what I have to offer you is life. But not just life, eternal life. Some things are worth sacrificing for. Think about it. If you want to, give me a call this week. We'll talk more about it. Let's pray. Gracious God, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity, for this time that we have together. Lord, I don't know what to say except thank you. Lord, if there's one in the midst or watching right now that has not experienced, that has not felt that sacrifice that that forgiveness that you offer to them, that freedom that they can experience, that love that permeates the soul, that peace. Gracious God, I pray that this will be the day. This will be the time that they will say, yes, Lord. I'm laying it all down. Here I am.
That I am and find my heart.
of your loving, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me. You will be with me. Here I am.
Of God and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Here I am.